Good morning, friends. It's so good to be with you this morning. And we are continuing our journey to look at God's big story. And this is a study that we are going to do in our life groups based on a book by Vaughan Roberts, looking at the Bible depicting the kingdom of God. Last week we looked how we can see in the beginning of Scripture there's a pattern for the kingdom, and then there's a lost kingdom, and then there's a promised kingdom, and we are now in the partial kingdom. Last week we began to look at how God rescued the Israelites out of Egypt, first individually with a sacrificial lamb, salvation by substitution, and then secondly as he led them through the Red Sea, salvation by conquest, God winning the battle against the Egyptians. Now we find the Israelites not only getting the law. After salvation, they received the law, but God also gave them plans for a tabernacle that God can be amongst them. And we continue the story. We see that the Israelites go to the edge of this promised land. They send in 12 spies, and this 12 spies come back with a good report, saying this is a land of abundance. There's a huge bunches of grapes. There's lots of animals and vegetation, but the people is huge. And 10 of the spies says, listen, we will be unable to conquer these cities. It's walled cities. It's strong people. It's a lot of people. But there's two that says, no, God has promised this to us. We can conquer this land. And many of us knows the story, but as you read from Numbers to Judges, we see how God first delays, because of their disobedience and unbelief, them inheriting the promised land. Then he raises up Joshua, and as Moses sends the people into the promised land, he did not enter the promised land. He tells them in Deuteronomy 28, today I put before you life and death, obedience or disobedience, blessing or curse. And he ends off this thing of blessing and curse, obedience and disobedience, with a call. Listen, choose life. Joshua goes on. He leads the people into the promised land, and they see God breaking walls of cities, God defeating armies, and the enemies fleeing in front of them. But it's not all obedience. Every now and again, people start following their own ways, start following their own heads, and they disobey God. And then sometimes calamity strikes, sometimes they just fall into a rhythm of disobedience and not being able to hear or see God. Then finally, as they are led continuously by judges in their conquest, as Samuel, the last judge, equips and raises up his sons to take over the role of judging Israel, the Israelites says, no, we want a king like the nations around us. Now Moses even warned them. God said, told Moses to warn the people. They will want kings like the nations around them, but I am their God and I will lead them. If they do choose a king, the king will burden them with taxes. He will take their sons into battle, their daughters as servants in his palace. Nonetheless, this is what they ask for. They want a king like the nations surrounding them, and should be careful what you ask for, because they get exactly what they ask for. Samuel is displeased with this request, but God reminds him, listen, it is me they have rejected, not you. I will give them a king. And to the four-step Saul. And Saul is this a head longer than anyone else, mighty to lead them in battle. But this is the kind of king they ask for. And he relies so much in his own strength. Even though he started off in humility, he oversteps his role time and again. And by the end of 1 Samuel 15, God speaks through Samuel and says, listen, your kingdom has been ripped from you. And in his place, a new king is anointed, David. But this David first experience, after his anointing, he experienced a rejection by people. He has to flee for his life before he steps into the role of king. But then, David leads the people. He's a man after God's own heart, but even in his sin, this kingdom is divided. And the roles of Israel and Judah comes into play. So David reigns. But even as David reigns, he realizes, and God promises him, that one greater than him will step to the fore, will be king. The king, the son of David, will be the son of God. And then we see the son of David, Solomon, being anointed as king, and he leads people, and the golden age of Israel has arrived. A promise is fulfilled, but that king turns from God. And as many after him, the kings turn from God. And as even as Samuel and as Nathan led the nation as prophets, being the voices of God, it continues. These prophets are the guys speaking God's words. Because the king was not meant to lead on his own and in his own wisdom, but he was meant to lead as God leads him. And the prophets are the guys that speaks God's word. And they speak God's words of judgment. We see that the kingdom is split in 922 years before Christ. And then later Israel is conquered. King Jeroboam's idolatry. Not only he committed idolatry, but also his sons, also those succeeding him. And the kingdom is destroyed 200 years after it split and it was established as the kingdom of Israel. In 722 before Christ, the Assyrians defeats Israel. And they are exiled. We see prophets being raised up, warning these guys about what is to come. But there is some good kings in the kingdom of Judah. But not all are good, but there is some. But we see this kingdom too is laced by corruption and compromise. Every now and again, idolatry slips in. Every now and again, disobedience is allowed. And they are defeated in 597 years before Christ by the Babylonian Empire. These prophets, through the reign of these kingdoms, these prophets were meant to communicate God's judgment over the nation of Israel and Judah. And the prophets remind them that the destruction of Israel and Judah is because of God's judgment. That's the reason. It's not because the nations are stronger. It is God's judgment that they are facing. You see, there has been two promises, two covenants. The covenant of Abraham that was without any without any conditions. God told Abraham, I will make you a great nation. I will increase your descendants to as many as the stars in the sky and the sand in the sea. And I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. And through you all nations will be blessed. There was nothing expected from Abraham. But the Mosaic covenant was a covenant of obedience, a covenant that meant people needed to obey. A covenant of obedience and disobedience, blessing and curse. And as the prophets reminded the people of this, that there's consequences to their choices, there was also a message of hope. There was a message of hope to the people that God would bring about a new exodus through the prophet Jeremiah. And through the prophet of Isaiah, that God would present a new Passover lamb. And that there will be all nations represented and included. And as Cyrus comes to reign, he sends back the people of Israel and Judah. But they are awaiting a king that could lead them in victory. And then we see Jesus stepping in. After 400 years of silence, Jesus steps in. And the life of Jesus was proclaimed and written down by Matthew, Mark, and Luke. This is the synoptic gospels. It's verbal parallels of the same story of Jesus Christ, how he lived on earth, how he was without sin, how he did miracles, raised the dead, made the blind see. And then we find the Gospel of John that is a different style. It's some unique material as John saw the love of Jesus Christ. But all four of these accounts is complementary accounts of the life of Jesus Christ while he was on earth. And it's the same overall message. Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophets. As Matthew starts, as Mark starts, as Luke starts, even as John starts, they remind us that this is the one that was promised by God. And in Jesus, God's people is represented. The true Israel. Jesus was tested for 40 days. He appointed 12 apostles. He reminded them that he is the vine and they are the branches. And that only through him we can bear fruit. Jesus is God's place. He refers to himself as God among us. The true tabernacle. And later he reminds them that he's the true temple. He even confuses the Pharisees as he says, listen, this temple will be torn down, but it will be rebuilt in 3 days. He is the true temple. And then Jesus is also God's rule and blessing. The true king, the son of David, he did miracles. He was the son of God. And he conquered sin and death once and for all. And in his resurrection, friends, we too can believe that there's life after death, that there is eternal life. And as Jesus dies on the cross, we are reminded, like the lamb that was slaughtered to be applied on the doorpost of the Israelites, Jesus Christ was crucified as substitute for me and you. And God's wrath is satisfied. We, in this new covenant, the covenant of grace, we stand forgiven. We stand before the Almighty Creator of heaven and earth. But we call Him Father. He calls us His children. We can have fellowship with God through Holy Spirit. But then we are called to proclaim this kingdom. This kingdom that is proclaimed. Even as Jesus started His ministry, He says the kingdom of God is at hand. And friends, you and I, living in the last days, the days after Jesus' ascension and before His return, living in this season and time, we are called to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. God wants everyone to hear the good news and to repent before it is too late, according to 2 Peter 3 verse 9. God sent us His Spirit. The gospel is being proclaimed, has been proclaimed, and continues to be proclaimed. And then we will see Jesus return. We do not know the day and time, but Jesus is coming back. But friends, in this last days, at the beginning of this, we see the Spirit of God being poured out on all men and women, as promised by the prophet Joel. In Joel 2, verse 28 to 32. And this promise is poured out on people like tongues of flames. They start speaking the gospel so that the people around them, every single one, can hear the gospel in their own mother tongue. Everyone stands astonished and says, "How can this be? This is mere fishermen." And then Peter steps up and he says, "Listen, this is what's promised. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ." We're living in the age of the Spirit of God. And He fills us and empowers us to witness about Jesus Christ. In Jerusalem, Judea, to the ends of the earth. Maybe it's reached the ends of the earth and it's going back to people that has forgotten it. For people that has fallen into idolatry like the early Christians, like the Israelites did. But the Holy Spirit also equips us to serve Christ. It enables us to witness, and it equips us for ministry with the gifts of the Spirit to build the church. The Holy Spirit also produces holiness. That is His work to bring us in us a sense of holiness. But then, as we have been diving into the book of Revelation, we see a perfected kingdom. The kingdom coming, where God will make all things new. We see a final judgment for those in Christ. We will have to give an account, but we will not be judged unto eternal hell. For those that has rejected Christ, Christ's words is clear that He will reject them. But then we see in this new creation the return of perfect relationship between God and man, perfect relationship between fellow believers, and then perfect relationships between humans and creation. And John cries out, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." We read of a place where there will be no more tears, no more sin. And friends, as we look at this, the second part, I want to encourage you. Would you commit yourself to this study? Would you become part of a life group? And I want us to ponder on this in terms of Holy Spirit. Are we fully dependent on Holy Spirit to lead us? Not only to bring about a new birth, but maybe today you are only considering following Jesus. Maybe today it dawned on you that it is the truth, that He is the way, the truth, and the life, and that He's the only way to stand right before your Maker. And then Jesus reminds Nicodemus that you have to be born again, born of flesh and of spirit. Have you been born again? Or are you trying your best in your own flesh? Amen. Jesus came to lay down His life that we can have life, and that in abundance. Friends, do we allow Holy Spirit to equip us? Not only as we read the Word, but as we step out in faith, praying for the sick, speaking to the lost. Now we dependent as a local church and as believers for Holy Spirit to come and produce in us holiness. So He leads us to change our ways. As He leads us to open eyes, open our eyes. Are we obedient? So I want to encourage you with this thing. Would you allow Holy Spirit to come and equip you to proclaim Christ and to serve Him? Would you allow Holy Spirit to lead you in obedience as He transforms us more and more into the image of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior? Let us pray. Lord God, thank You for this beautiful picture of Your kingdom. And Lord God, thank You that we can be now in this time where we can proclaim the kingdom. But Lord, thank You that we can look forward to a perfected kingdom. Lord, but I pray that You will make us very effective in this time right now, Lord God, to be a people fully dependent on Your Spirit, to equip us, to empower us with boldness, Lord God, and to make us walk in obedience as we follow You. Holy Spirit, I pray if there's any sin among us, Lord God, that You will not only reveal it, but that You will make us bold to repent and turn, to obey You fully. Lord, I pray that our ears may be open, Lord, as You lead us to friends, to family, Lord God, to stranger, to testify of the wonderful work You've done in our lives, Lord God, and the wonderful salvation that is available to all who choose to believe in You as Lord and Savior. Lord, and I pray that You will grow us in holiness. Lord, that we will evermore be dependent on how You lead us. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, thank you for joining us. May you have a blessed day. Join the life group.
All the saints and angels, they bow before Your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing, You worthy of it all. You were